Hey everyone, welcome to A Convo with Legends, brought to you by artesia-pro and EFNOTE Drums. My name is Mike Bedard. I'm the product specialist and drum expert, and we couldn't be more honored to have the two legends that we have with us here to help bring to market the new EFNOTE 3 and EFNOTE 5 drum sets. On stage right, we have a legend that held the drum chair for a very long time with Chicago and Kenny Loggins, played on the albums, put in all the work, Tris Imboden. Yeah. Welcome to I'm Out of My League with... Over here, we have, I think, Tris's best friend on earth. These guys have got an incredible chemistry. Holds the drum chair with Earth, Wind, and Fire, is a super, super pocket player, and just, you'll see here in seconds, John Paris. Yeah, both of these guys are as humble as it gets, and it's almost uncomfortable to even talk about how great they are, but I've been hearing how great they are here in the room. So let's talk some drums and do some playing. And let the people hear what we have going on. Hello, everyone in the chat room. Actually, you know what? Let's go to some of these. Lorraine, hello. Laurent, hello. Buddy, hi. Drum guy, I know you. Hey there. Saxman Marco, that's Marco Samaniego. Hey-o. Andy W., good to see you, man. Mark Lambert, hello from Oz. Nice. Good day, mate. Braxton Mars. Great songwriter in the house. I love it. Man, we've got a packed house. Oh, I love it. Aloha. Sup? Jeff, greetings. I love it. Yes. We've got a big room in here tonight. So let's jump into these kits. Over here on the left, we've got the EFNOTE 3. This is about to go to market here this month. And the things are on the ship and are about to go live. Could you...
And they sound amazing.
Yeah, man. Whoops. Yeah. Easy for you to say. Is that?
Yeah. You know I had to get in there on the trip. Oh, man.
The man behind everything, Florentino Buenaventura.
What's up, sir? This is what the CEO does of the company. Just my story. I'm sorry. I didn't want to follow you again.
Am I killing the audio with my voice? Okay, good. John, could you give us a little bit of that kit?
Yeah, and they sound amazing.
I love it.
The original.
And I just want to remind everyone that it's not Michael Jordan's shoes that dunk for Michael Jordan. It's Michael Jordan. So if he was to go barefoot with no Air Jordans, he would still dunk. Okay? The skills are in these guys' hands because these drums are so real that you still can sound bad on them. I know because I have sounded bad on them. I have. I mean it. I mean it. It's not a built-in, as soon as you sit down, it goes. These things are the real deal. They respond and react like real drums, so
yeah.
Don't slip. No, I'm right. Anyway, let's talk a little bit about your history. And the guys have been out on the road. They've done 5 world tours together with Chicago and Earth, Wind, and Fire. They've got something so special between them. But where did it all begin for you, John?
For me, well... The thing that comes to mind is we were doing, as far as a connection with Tris and I, we were doing the corporate gig up in Portland, remember? Mm-hmm. And we saw each other, you know, the whole, you know, we just that's almost more fun than playing. And, you know, everybody's doing this the whole time. What if we should Yeah, let's get together, right, and do something. That was, what year was that? Do you remember?
It was at least 3 years before it happened.
Yeah. So we just kept throwing it out there, and then, yeah. Yeah, 2002 or 2001?
2002, because the first tour was 2004.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
so, yeah, we just kept grinding it and grinding it. We would throw it out to people. You know, some friends asked for opinion, and they were like, oh, yeah. You guys should do it. But it just kept, you know.
Gaining momentum.
Yeah. Until finally. But the coolest thing, though, that happened, you know, and I tell them the story. I tell people this story all the time. I'm doing a sound check after I finish geeking out about who I'm looking at in the room. Oh, Robert Lamb, Pinkham, just duh. This guy was, he's one of my heroes.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I tell you the truth. You know, I mean, I followed him for years. Mm-hmm. And to find out, you know, he's an incredible human being on top of his amazing playing just shot me to the moon, right?
Oh,
so
man.
I'm excited. I'm getting on the kit, and I'm like, yeah, okay, let me see what's going on. I don't know if we had had we gone in ears yet? We did.
Yeah. I think so.
So yeah. I still have this huge wedge behind me, you know, because I didn't have a thumper at that time, so I'm just playing, you know, thinking of September, playing it, and I'm like, yo, it sounds huge. I'm still playing. Like my God, I'm looking over at my sound man because he was, you know, to the left. The Tris, he's playing at the same time, and we both just bust out laughing. Now everybody knows, you know, it's going to work, right? Because there was all this pressure, you know, unbeknownst to us that, well, you know, he'll play then, and then I'll play my song, and, you know, that kind of a thing, because you're not going to ever get two drummers to, you know.
To play wide open.
But like with that, this guy,
man,
I had no clue what was happening. I didn't even try, you know, to look at his feet or his, none of that. It just locked, like, and I just busted out laughing and almost started crying at the same time.
Yeah, you guys have a very undeniable pocket. Yeah. Just to let the people that are watching this know, you know, we were looking to try to get some backing tracks, right, to get these guys to play together. And the ones that we found, there was no clicks for him, right? And then you look and the little asterisk said, you know, estimated tempo. So the tempo does this little thing and the pocket does this little thing. Now for most musicians, that's kind of, that throws you off if you're not at a certain level of awareness of that time. And these guys took right to it and it was just no big, oh, no click, no problem. Even if it breathes or whatever, because they listen so well, they listen so big, which is one of the millions of things that puts them at the level they're at. But
and
how about for you, Tris?
When did you know
that, you know?
Oh, that connect was there, like, no pun intended, written in the stone.
Yeah.
man, from the first bar, I mean, it was so evident. It was just amazing, and it was effortless.
Yes.
And I've played double drums with other drummers before that I thought It would be magical, but for whatever reason, just how where they felt it and where I felt it, it wasn't like this, you know.
Yeah.
This was effortless.
Yeah. Mm.
And I gotta say that first of all, it takes two gentlemen to play double drums, and I could not be playing with a finer gentleman than this man right here. He is one of the greatest human beings I've ever had the pleasure of knowing. Not to mention the most talented, too.
Yeah.
I absolutely love him.
Who are you talking about, Mike?
Yeah.
I thought you were talking about...
I'm talking about you, that's right.
John, what was the first band you were ever in?
Oh, my God. So you want to go back there?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, ironically enough, it was a band called Heaven and Earth. Because we were Earth, Wind & Fire fans.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
You know, so, yeah, the guy, my guy, shout out to Jay Logan, he was our musical director at the time, pulled me out of the music room and made me play, actually, because I loved to play drums, but I was really shy, still even in high school. But I told a story about how we got these amazing tickets twice, you know, for two shows in a row for Earth, Wind & Fire, and the bass player, Rodney Hill, was the guy who was with me at the time we went. So we, you know, we played a bunch of shows when we were younger and, you know, got a bunch of tomatoes and stuff thrown at us. But it was helping us figure it out.
Yeah.
But that was way back, I mean, 70,
blah, blah. Back in there. But then, you know, we all continued, you know, a lot of, you know, musicians in the Bay Area, you know, continued to intermingle, and mm-hmm. we all would play with each other here and there. And after you get fired a couple of times, you figure it out.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah, it eventually I...
Crazy, all the steps,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
All
yeah.
the steps, and then you end up with the gig at Earth, Wind & Fire.
Well, that's funny that you say that, because, you know, a lot of people want to swing that. Shining star, yeah. So right. I couldn't do that back then. I was, you know, okay, my bass player is one of my best friends. He'll cover for me. He's right. looking at my foot. Right. He's looking at my foot. And this goes to show you can have many friends, really good friends, but when it comes to music, gloves are off. He's looking at me. I got fired the next day because I couldn't play Shining Star.
Oh, man.
They fired me.
Yeah, oh. From the cover band fired yeah. you. And then you end up playing it every
My
night.
My buddies. Then, you know, I don't rub it in their face, but I'm just saying.
Yeah. yeah
that's that. Probably the best thing to happen to me, though.
Yeah.
Because I went yeah. home for a couple of years and went.
Yeah. Matt, please, could you show us that groove?
That was it. Now, see, this is what I learned from Freddie and Ralph live. You know, the record. But they said, one.
Yeah.
And your shoulder.
Ah.
You put your yeah. shoulder in there.
Right.
Yeah.
This kind of helps it sink a little bit.
Yeah.
There, see?
I love it, man. And Tris, what about you? Where did it begin for you? Like, when did you know that it was, you know, going to be what you were going to do? And what band?
Well, man, you know, I mean, it sounds funny, but I was in high school. And I was in a band. It was pretty good because, you know, the guys that were singing were cute, you know, so the girls loved them. And you know, we were doing Little Rascal tunes and, you know, some Beatles and British Invasion stuff. And anyway, we got asked to open for Stevie Wonder
wow.
at the Marina Palace in Seal Beach. And so I haven't told this story.
I love it.
At all. And, anyway, man, when we got done, some of the guys in the band came over to me and said, Stevie wants to meet you. And I was like, what?
Yeah.
And I was like,
yes.
What? So, yeah, so I think I was 16. And wow. Anyway, man, he put his arm around me and said, man, you know where it's at. I was like, ooh. What? That was like a sanctification. I mean,
yeah.
my all-time hero yes. heard something in my playing that he liked.
Yeah.
And so that was it. And little Stevie Wonder wasn't so little at that point. He was, you know, I'm little. He was, he towered over me. I mean, not only like physically, but of course, it's Stevie
yeah.
Wonder.
Yeah,
know,
wow.
So, yeah.
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 That's a great story.
So,
though.
Man, I knew then that I had something.
Yeah.
You know, that I should probably follow up.
Yeah,
on, so.
It's special, man. Yeah. It's definitely yeah. special when you guys play together as well. hey, everybody that's in the chat room, feel free to shoot over some questions. We're going to periodically look through here, and shout-outs are always good. Hey, good morning from the Philippines.
Ooh.
Hello from Canada. We're going worldwide.
Greetings,
Jeff. Elvin J., hi. Hello from Fayetteville. All right, all nice.
All right.
Here we go. Has it started? Yes, it has started. I hope we're live.
Can
let's
you see us?
Wow, there's so many. I love it. We're going to...
Yay.
Okay, we're hearing turn up the audio.
Ah.
Done.
Maybe by speaking to Mike, they can hear him.
And then everything goes boom.
Yeah.
Speaking of audio, you guys wanna play a song together?
Sure.
Of course.
Love to hear it. Love to hear these drums smacking down.
Let's do it.
Shall we?
Yeah.
Man. Oh, heavy, heavy, heavy. On, man. That's with no clicks. That's with no clicks.
Could you tell? You could tell, right?
I want drummers to know that. That's such a confident, amazing pocket. How are these drums? How's the snap?
Oh, man. Okay. I've never felt electronic drums that have a snap like this.
Right on.
Ever in my life. There's absolutely zero latency.
That part.
Yeah, I've found the same.
God,
that part.
It's amazing. And yeah. The dynamic range.
Yes.
Man, I mean, from a roar to a whisper.
Ah, yep.
Yeah.
You know, it's huge.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
When Florentino first showed me these drums, I had no idea if it was going to, you know, be something I could get behind just because you're looking at them. They look great.
Right.
But then when I started playing them, it was like, wow, yeah. Immediate. Yeah. Immediate.
You forget, you know, that you're playing an electronic kit after
yeah.
a while.
Yeah.
You just really start laying into them. You can really feel it coming back. It's almost like some wood coming back at me, but... Wow.
Exactly.
It's not plastic, but
yeah.
You hear that metal? You hear that?
Even that doesn't sound like rubber and a mylar head.
Right.
You know, when you hit the edge of the tom-tom.
Exactly.
Yeah. How's that possible? I mean, you can even do cross sticks, like cross stick glisses like that.
Yes.
Yeah, so cool.
Ah. Yes, sir. Uh-huh.
You know, reacting like the real
amazing.
Thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, unbelievable.
Wait, let's take a couple of questions. We've got some questions in the chat. Let's see. Laurent says, what's your overall take on e-drums? I'm an older drummer, and I'm personally digging them a lot.
Well, you're no older than us, that's for sure. No, but like Tris said, you know, this is the first time, really, because, you know, to be honest with you, I was not... Yeah, you know, they weren't my favorite instrument to play, you know, electric drums. But in fact, I told Tris a story last year, you know, when Florentino first approached me about it, you know, I was kind of running around avoiding him a little bit. It was like, yeah, electronic drums, yeah, they're great, right? Until I heard them. Then when I heard them, you know, the sounds were incredible, but to actually sit and play them and hear it back, it's incredible. These, you know, we're talking about EFNOTE, unbelievable.
Yes.
Unbelievable.
Yep.
Nice. Love it.
Yep.
Let's see. We got another one here. Let's see. From George. He says, how often do you have to replace a kit due to wear and tear of touring? So this is a kit question. I'm used to a head question, but
that's a kit question.
Well, now that's a difficult thing because I haven't taken these on the road yet.
Yeah. But in general, even sounds like it's just for...
Well, up with my acoustic drums,
yeah.
I'm a spoiled brat. And I have a tech who changes my snare head, if not nightly, it's every other night. Mm-hmm. And then the toms are usually like every, you know, 3 or 4 shows.
Yeah.
And bass drums less than that.
Yeah.
You know, if left to my own devices, I'm not that ambitious.
You sent the kid on the text today, right? Uh-huh. That this horribly just dilapidated drum set. Yeah, like, yeah, the background for tonight. It was just it had a wood block like screwed into the front of the kick drum. Yeah.
Sounds good though.
Yeah. I gotta say the hang with these two guys has been so wonderful. And I know that Andy Zildjian says this a lot. You know, there's something special about being in the room with drummers. There's an energy when you're together, and the camaraderie that's there is so cool, and I'm just I'm super honored to be here with you guys.
Thank you.
And with everyone that's in here, but I'm definitely resonating on this right now. It's really wonderful.
We feel the same with you, Mike.
Absolutely, brother Mike. Thank
you
so much.
Here's another one from one of my old buddies, Marco. Let's see. I love how the cymbals respond from the bell to crash and the quick stop on the hi-hat. Nice. You want to show a little bit?
Yeah. How about this?
Ha! Nice. Hey, can you show? So these cymbals, all the cymbals have 3 zones, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. If you get the, each of them's got 3 zones. The thing that's special about these that is unique to EFNOTE is the whole cymbal. It's the 360 range of playing, right?
Yes.
So you can choke it, or you can play it anywhere on the cymbal, and it reacts from the optical sensors that it has. Yeah. so you.
Yeah.
Yes, and yeah. And you've got the bell, the edge, and the bow right there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They were incredible to me. They sold me on the kit. Let's see. Oh, I'm hearing speak to Mike. I hope I'm not blowing anyone's ears out. It sounds like maybe the opposite. Let's see. Do the drums with acoustic shells make sound when they're not plugged in? Do they double as acoustic at all? The only real head that there is on stage is this guy. And that's pretty much there to, when you kick it, when you bury the beater, right? You like, do you feel that in your foot?
Absolutely.
And then yeah. Feel the difference of this?
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So there's resonance in that shell. There's a real drum shell, obviously. It's a six-ply birch shell that's there. And they put that front head on. I thought it was genius. Instead of doing the mesh head, but no, if you were to turn these off, you won't hear anything. You won't hear any noise. Your neighbors won't hear any noise, which is a good selling point to any parents. Is it?
And apartment dwellers.
Oh, here's somebody. This is from Mike. Says, Tris, watching you with Chicago was so influential in me starting to play again after 50 years, and then all caps lock. Thank you.
Oh, wow. Man.
Amazing. We hear, let's see, cymbals sound amazing. I agree, and thank you very much. Let's see. Oh, what books do you still use to practice?
Oh.
That'd be a Tris question.
Only because I have a teacher now.
Too. Mine's a YouTube.
Well, YouTube for sure.
Do you do that Kademski book? Do you do that one?
Well, actually, I'm still, you know, going back. I find myself going back to Syncopation Ted Reed.
Yeah.
And Stick Control by Lawrence Stone.
Woo.
Mm. But the Bible for me was always Advanced Techniques for the Modern Drummer by Jim Chapin, which was written in the 40s.
Yeah.
And it's what opened up all jazz players.
Yeah.
Man, you know, to be able to, again, spang, spang a lang, do all that stuff with the foot and the hand.
Yeah, it's like boot camp meets Groundhog Day. It's every day you're just like, oh, trying to get through that. It's like the worst book to get through, but it leaves you with the best prize.
Man. And it's so applicable, you know, in rock and roll even, because you get your independence together and you can do all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
You know? So, yeah.
What's the longest tour you've ever been out on?
Probably my second tour with Patti LaBelle in 91. I'd say it was like 9 months.
Wow.
We did so many shows. We got a plaque from the promoter and some big old champagne gold-plated names. I mean, somebody made a lot of money on that. Yeah, but I think it was, it wasn't a consistent 9 months, but you only got, you know, 3 months to play with in there, but... back to back, a couple of those, and then we kept rolling.
Yeah,
it was pretty hard. Yeah. It was rough.
What about you, Tris? What's
Right about 1988, I was dividing my time between Kenny Loggins and Al Jarreau. Mm.
Wow.
And, both were like dream gigs, but, you know, playing with Al Jarreau. Oh, man, you know, that was a drummer's gig. And Kenny, you know, is so brilliant, but so kind of controlling in the way he wants things heard. He doesn't want a lot of improvisation. So, but with Jarreau, it's like, bring it every night, man. And the more you do, the more he loved you for it, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so it was the perfect foil. But in 88, I went from a full-on, like, you know, 6 months with Kenny into, like, four, like, it was about 3 months in Europe, maybe 3.5 months. I'd never been out of the country that long. Mm-hmm. When I got home, as much as I love Europe, I kissed the ground on the U.S. soil, you know. Oh,
how many shows a week were you guys doing?
Now, with Al, because he would always try to protect his instrument.
Absolutely.
And so it was like 3.5 shows a week, which was so cushy.
That's great. Yeah.
But it was like you could sightsee and see all these places, and we were staying in the nicest hotels in Europe. But it was per diem busters, you know.
Right. Yeah, for sure.
Everything
lock,
was so expensive. Yeah, exactly. It was a lot of McDonald's, you know.
Hey, what was it like going from a super structured gig to a super wide open gig? Was it, what was the proximity, I guess, you know, between the two and the, you know, that change, the gear change?
Well, man, it was just like, you mean if I hear something, I can play it and I won't get stink eye from the singer?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Did you just change over, though?
Well, no, it took me a while. Yeah. It really did. I like my feel, you know, because I don't consider myself a jazz player. I play at it. I love jazz, and I've, you know, done some, but I'm not like, you know, one of those guys, you know? And but Al, even though he sang R&B, too, he was basically a jazz singer. Yeah. That's where he came from, you know? Yeah. So it was a transition. It took some time, but boy, did I love it, man. Yeah. It was so good for me. Mm. Yeah. You know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's really interesting. Absolutely. Like the gears that you have to change as a working musician, you know, no matter what level, if it's local, it's crazy. Punk rock one night and jazz the next night, right?
Yeah.
And then if you're out on something that's that consistent, like you're doing Patti LaBelle, what were you doing close to Patti LaBelle or around time-wise?
Nothing.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Just that.
Yeah, that was, you know, I mean, everything... after and before was relatively structured. But her gig, you could throw the set list away after the intro. Oh. She's going to want to do whatever she wants to do, you better be ready. It was like that. Yeah. So there was this unspoken tension between the entire band, which created, you know, an energy that she needed, you know, to inspire her. Whatever he calls, whatever she calls, whatever it is, if you should know the song. Nice. And let's go. That one song that's way down there, three quarters of the way, could come in the middle if she feels like she wants to roll on the floor a little earlier. So at any moment, there was this tune.
Literally.
Isn't It a Shame by LaBelle, and we would also do that. And the cue was... the musical director would play it on the piano. Wasn't none of that. And he would just sit down at any moment and go, blum, 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 and that's what it felt like. Playing that now, okay? Yeah. So, you know, you were really spent, you know, mentally, too, after that gig. You know, and this was kind of like before the union would cut you off at 90 minutes. You know, we'd do 2-hour shows and... You know, hopefully Stevie wouldn't show up and want to sing. You'd be in there for another hour.
Right.
You know, so that one, that was the one that was the most challenging, you know, as far as structure was concerned.
Yeah. So cool. Going.
You fall asleep like this.
The diversity of your skill set, you know, to handle that level. Gave my buddy Brandon sings with Patti.
Yeah.
Now a lot, and it's like the band is insane.
He knows.
But that's definitely a testament to your skill set, which is nuts. Hey, we've got another legend up in here in the room, Pete Zappadin, who is someone that I grew up looking up to playing. He's an incredible rudimental drummer and educator, writes books and text on playing. And he's got something. He says, and he used to go see you at the Baked Potato.
Oh my God.
Back in the day. We were texting the other day, and he's like, dude, you're doing something with Tris.
Oh, man,
That's awesome.
And is a great friend of Dave Ramirez.
Man, great. I love Dave.
Pete says, how did you develop your Latin chops? You were so amazing with Cecilia Noel. Love you, Tris.
Oh, man. Thank you. Well, I love Latin music. It was actually Claire Fisher. I was playing with Jeff Berlin and doing a fusion band with Jeff Berlin, the great bass player, and Claire Fisher was in his band, Jeff Berlin's band. So Claire liked my feel, and he said, "Do you ever play any Latin?" I was like, "No." He said, "Do you want to?" I guess. So he said, "Okay, be in my house at Thursday, and I'll teach you to play some Latin." And basically, with his band, it was hi-hat and bass drum. You played the tumbao on the bass drum and hi-hat and stay the hell out of the way because it's Luis Conte and Manchito Sanchez that are, got all the stuff to say, you know.
Yeah.
And, man, so that's how I started.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I love it. We got another good one. A couple of good ones. Let's see. Here's one from Benny O. I think it's Benny O or Benny Joe. It's, how do you guys stay healthy during your tours?
A lot of hamburgers and fries and shakes.
It doesn't have to be good health. Even bad health is still health, right?
It's health, right. Oh, man. Well, don't let this guy kid you, because on my infrequent visits to the gym, he was there. Right. Always. Yeah, no, I
beat me in there again.
John's like a superhero on the drums.
He does. He is, man.
It goes like this when he starts playing.
But what's the process for you guys? You know, when you're in a plane, trainer, automobile. Huh? Mm-hmm. Probably not a train unless you're in Europe.
Yeah, right.
You know, and then it's catering, and then it's a hotel, and it's a right. You know, mm-hmm. snacks all over the place, and all that stuff. How do you do it? How do you stay healthy?
That's well for me. I try not to eat too much at night while I watch everybody eating.
Right.
You know, on the bus, because that's the thing. And with Chicago anyway, they'd order dinner for us, and it would be waiting for us on the bus before we go to the next city. Mm-hmm. And man, it was so hard not to eat every night late. You know, and then try to get up and go to the gym, but that helped pass the day.
Yeah.
You know, too.
Yeah.
Help the
Absolutely.
Time go.
Yeah.
So yeah.
And what about you?
Well, it depends on, you know, like that, what he was saying. If we're traveling that night and we have a show, then there would be no intentional cardio, you know, the next day. You know, I would take a break and, you know, do a lot of isometric stuff. But, you know, the funniest thing, you know, what I would love is to do sit-ups on the bus while it's moving.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because you have use your core. Yeah.
Oh,
you
man,
have to use
that's
it.
So smart.
So I would do that in the evening, and some, you know, most of the stretches is kind of scary because you're trying to stretch a hammy and you hit a bump. It's like, oh. So that's where the sit-ups came in, you know. I would do those in the evening, and it would kind of help me relax. So that way I could get up, eat, and try, you know, to get in the gym. I would love to get in the gym on the show, but, you know, it's enough of this going on that day, so I would wait till the next day. But a lot of greens, you know, not, you know, carbs. I'm trying to pull back on those now, but, you know, before the show, you know.
You need them. You kind of need them for
carbs
the energy.
And lots and lots of water. Lots of water. You know, just like boss killing the water, you know. So,
speaking of which.
Great. Yeah,
yeah. Feel free at any time. So everybody in the chat room, we're gonna play Name That Groove.
Oh,
okay. And we haven't gone to market yet, so there's no prize other than what drummers already love, which is saying I was right. So you and everyone else in the room gets to point fingers at whoever gets it wrong. But jump up in the chat room. We're gonna have each guy queue up his own kit so we could show you some more of these drum sets. And they're gonna play some bars of famous grooves. It might be grooves that they recorded. Or just iconic grooves. And as soon as you see them, throw them up in the chat. And no Shazam. Just kidding.
All my favorites. Nothing that I've recorded.
All right. So.
Oh, man.
We're going to say
not mine. I love what you recorded.
Oh, here's one. Here, one. Before we do that, Larry Rizzo says, how is the snare drum sensitivity when playing comping patterns in an up-tempo bop?
Mm. Oh, well.
It's a good one, yeah.
You want to demonstrate?
You can do it.
No.
Yeah, you go.
I can't play up-tempo bop that well, but.
Yeah. He sent a zinger. Who are you, Larry Rizzo?
See. Hold on. Yeah, let me get a bop kit up here. So.
My snappy answer to that would be, you know, dynamics.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, the buzz rolls and like that. Mm-hmm. It doesn't machine gun too much, like they say, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
It's really, really sensitive and feels like a real snare. And feels like a real snare drum, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good one.
It is a good one. That's with me with playing it. I get to play these every day. I've got a set of these and then two other companies' kits that are at the same price point because I have to kick these things apart every day. And no,
come
no.
on, Mike. Yeah. Come on.
And what I end up hearing on it is with each of these firmware updates that they send to make the drum more dynamic, more sensitive, is it's up to me to get in and shape the drum to adjust the curve and the threshold. And especially, like I said, it's not Michael Jordan's shoes that, you know, throw the dunks. It's Michael Jordan's skills. So the more I practice on it, the more dynamic I play, the more the drum is and reacts. So cool. Let's see. Tell Uncle Tris, always my inspirations as a kid, Jonathan P., most solid groove that lasts a lifetime.
Yeah. Oh,
so I swear, we're going to save all these.
Oh, that's sweet.
All right, let's play Name That Groove.
Name That Groove.
So everybody that's in the... there's a great clarity. Everybody that's in the chat room, feel free to chime in. Who wants to start?
Let's see. Throw him a curveball.
Here we go, beat number one. Keep it going. Hey! Come. Anybody? I say kick it. Somebody's going to get it. Kick it again. Okay. Somebody's going to get it.
Should we start with the intro? No. 3, 4.
Not yet. It begins with an S. Who's on it? Who's on it? Somebody jump. I put in a hint. Oh, we got it. Red Lee says soul vaccination.
Yes.
There we go.
You got it.
I know you saw it even before I sent it. Ooh, somebody was close. JC says, what is hip? Same incredible drummer. Different song. And now hopefully nobody was gonna do what is hip. No, I'm just playing. All right, beat number two. Here we go.
Come on, T.
Variations on a theme.
Okay.
Ooh.
That was the interlude. It was so short on the record. If somebody gets that, you're going to have to give them a prize if they catch it.
Damn.
Because we want to go for the really obscure one, so.
Yeah, let's go iconic. Let's cut right down the middle and then take them obscure gradually.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Well,
let's see.
John?
What'd I say?
Who's in? It's the most sampled. Oh, let's see. Thing sounds good. A lot of e-drums don't have good sensitivity when playing fast and light. That's the wrong song. But close.
No.
Get it. Get it. Get it. Get the jump. We're getting there. We're getting there. Come on, I feel it. I'm getting, nope, LOL, that's not the song. Oh, the funky drummer.
Oh, he said it.
He said it?
He got it. No, somebody got it. Yeah, they got it, yeah.
Good.
That's Jaffo, J-O-F-F-O.
You got it.
All right.
Good job, Jaffo. You're better than everybody in that room. Just kidding. Yeah, BK, funky drummer.
Come on. Okay.
These three, they should start a band, the funky drummers. Who's next?
So, see.
Ah. Oh, I got it. Do we count? Can
yes.
I guess too? I can guess.
You gotta log in.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Huh. I'll give him a hint. There have been times in my life. Yeah. Uh-huh. Ah, they got it?
Yes. That's, okay, we got the artist.
That's the tune.
Come on, go a little bit further.
That's the tune that I thought that when I really started falling in love with this guy's playing.
Oh, yeah.
Because I thought it was one of our heroes.
Oh, yeah.
Can I say? Or should I not?
Please do.
I thought it was Steve Gadd.
Right.
I did.
Yeah,
I thought.
Yeah, yeah, and I get that.
If I fooled him, then I succeeded.
we got the artist. Who's? Oh, whoa!
Oh, they
sorry,
got
everybody.
Artist?
I didn't even float down to like the 30. This is it. that just came through. Excellent. So that was Tris on the recording. That was Tris that actually played that, and that was one of the many records you saw going up the spiral stairway to heaven.
I got a real easy one. I got an easy one.
I love it.
Really easy one.
Yeah.
Ready?
Oh, yeah. Come on, who's in? Come on, let's go.
I told you that was an easy one. They got it? Anybody got it?
No, I'm hearing nice groove, and that's I'm still hearing Kenny Loggins. I got one. It. There we go, JC. I think JC's two for two.
JC, okay.
Yep, superstition.
I'm gonna trick JC.
Jesus Christ
on this
in the
one.
House.
I'm gonna trick him. But you go on this one. I got one. I bet you he doesn't know.
I love it.
I think.
MRC drum, or Mr. C drum, is Sissy Strut.
Yes!
Bing, 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 bing,
yes!
Bing. Beow, beow, beow. All right. Yes. And somebody just picked up the old RBI with Superstition. Oh, man.
Okay,
love you guys in the chat room. This
one.
Is so much fun. This is great. Oh, nice. Here we go. Oh!
Oh my God.
No, keep it going. I think I know who's gonna get it.
Oh man.
I'll give you a hint.
That's frightening.
There's a 7 in the name. That is the hardest beat ever to play, by the way.
God, man, yeah.
No, almost,
he almost
JC, you're
is
close.
Is close? What did he say?
He said starting something.
You know? Oh, that's another hard one.
You can definitely do a remix, right?
No, I'm not even going to try that. Yeah, he's close, but.
Yes, there we go. Mike Anderson's got it.
Wait a minute. Mike Anderson.
777.
Mike Anderson.
Brett Lee.
Oh, that's not fair. I know him.
Hey, Mike Anderson.
Yeah. Did you already say what it was?
Yeah. He said
okay.
It.
Damn
oh,
it.
Okay. I think
I love you,
what's
Mike.
Going on.
I love you, Mike.
I think there's a now. There's like let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Oh, I
six,
see.
Seven,
it.
Eight,
they got
nine.
It. Okay.
There's
okay.
About 12 people that got it now, and I think there's a bit of a delay.
Okay. Cool. All right.
That's what's happening.
Well, this is crazy fun.
Hey, our guy programmed that hi-hat. I meant to tell you that. David.
David,
yes.
Did.
Yeah.
Oh,
did you know
God.
That?
What's
the,
that?
For the Lynn drum, David, our guy David, program that.
Amazing.
David Garibaldi.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Somebody said, I need you to program something very... okay. I'm going to go into my impressions.
The two drummers I know that play it super well is Chris Brady from Aquarian Drumheads.
Oh, yeah.
He is so nasty. He's such a great... it's just over. He's like, yeah, come over into the drum room and we'll just hang out. And he just destroys it. And
pulls out the blowtorch.
Jared Harris. Incredible multi-instrumentalist that started Slapback. His band was Slapback. So he just murders that. But anyway, blah, blah, blah. yes, nice. Yeah, Pete, Jeff did nail it.
All right.
Awesome, fellas. Well, what do you say we play another song?
Okay, we can do that.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Stop me from talking.
All right.
I remember this.
Pocket and just the joy that you play with is like why people should be playing drums. Straight up, just amazing.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
So we got another question. It's from Remo, who has the most drum name ever. Unless this is the company asking this question. it is. Sorry if this got asked already, which it probably did, and I probably missed it. But what are each of these kits retailing for? The EFNOTE 3 is starting at $19.99. It's all-inclusive. Comes with the Lambda tripod stands that you can actually take these stands and squeeze this thing. They can fit. You can reverse them and go kind of like W style in here and get them in really tight, or you can spread them out and play a really wide setup. Both of the kits share the same module. So, for the most part, there's a couple of different sounds, but the majority of the sounds are common on each kit, super editable. But this kit, the 5, starts with this hardware pack starts at $24.99. So very competitive kit, and has a couple of zingers on it. The splash, 8-inch splash, is very special. Both of these kits on the snare, if you can see down here, there's a side stick bar, a little cross stick.
Yeah.
So you don't have to go over and hit the module to, oh, now I want to play side stick, now I want to play snare drum or whatever. So, yep, simple as that.
Right.
So that's what the that's what the retail is about to be. Let's see. Oh, don't forget the Zorro crushes it as well. True.
7-7 he's
speaking of. Yep, for sure.
I saw him doing it.
Uh-huh. Oh, Jeff says, where's Danny's five-stroke roll during the verses?
Like, okay, respect here we go. Now we're getting into it. Respect to Danny. That's his thing.
Mojo says, and I'm not effing it for him. He actually spelled F'N, but so effing awesome. Made my week. Dying for live, and this filled it tonight. Thank you, Mojo. Appreciate that very much. Colleen says, so good to see your smiling faces together again. Love you both. Elard says, amazing. Pete Zappanen, awesome. Ross on drums. How does the tuning change? Okay, so the way the tuning is, it's pretty typical with e-drum kits, but you just go to the tuning in the module. There's an edit page for each kit. So you go to edit, and then you'll see tuning, you'll see threshold. Nice. There's a big range of tuning that you can do, and there's a huge dynamic range in it. You can control the curve of it. So if you're going to be playing something, you know, really light and not so dynamic, and you need to engage and cut, you know, at a while you're playing lightly, you can, you know, bend the curve, or you can take away the curve either way. So there's a lot of flexibility with these kits.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's crazy.
Yeah, and the ease of getting to it is something I have not experienced in any other electronic hit.
Doug A says, will these be sold in Australia? And Doug, I want you to send me an email at mikeb@artesia-pro.com, and I'll get back to you on that about Australia. And if anybody has a question, mikeb@artesia-pro.com, and I'll be getting back to everyone. I'll try to keep the emails concise and to the point. Mm-hmm. All right? Mm-hmm. Let's see what else we got in here. Let's see, you showed the Elvany kit, right?
Yeah. But one thing I wanted to point out about that, though, on the bop kit,
oh, that bass drum. Ooh.
Check that bass drum. I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can hear that head
bending. Yeah, the flex. Yeah.
And the response. So that front head, man, it's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was extremely impressed. Right. You know, the way that I came to Artesia was Florentino. Got me to do an interview, which turned into having a great vibe with the crew and everyone here. And mm-hmm. and then he's like, there's this drum company, this new company that I think you'll be a good fit at, because, you know, you like drumming, you like talking to people, you like doing, you know, the thing that I'm doing now, which is crazy because I didn't think I'd end up doing this. But the thing that really, really, really sold me on the company was these kits and their openness to engineer and to change for the better of the drum. You know, like there was things that I represented them at the NAMM show, and there was things that we talked about with the engineers who are incredible, and they went back to their hotel room, you know, wrote software, and then came back with a firmware update and made changes on the fly at NAMM. That blew my mind. Wow. And that was many months before I started working officially for Artesia and EFNOTE. But anyway, I just wanted to sing those praises because I think that this is the future of drumming in the electric arena.
Absolutely.
I really do think it is.
Absolutely. Yeah.
100.
Let's see what else we got here. Two of my drumming influences in the same room. Bunch of exclamations. I'm so grateful. Oh, I've met John, but not Tris yet. John, meet Bebo.
Hey,
I mean,
Bebo.
Tris, meet Bebo.
Good to meet you.
Yeah.
I wish you were here.
Yeah.
Right.
If we could be there, that would be even better.
Thank you, EnterTalk, for getting my email in there. Let's see, what else we have?
Terry Bozio. Oh, my
God. Oh, please.
Okay.
Vinny in the house.
No. Vinny.
Oh, no.
Drummer Girl says,
I'm out of
here. Great for practicing in apartments for sure. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
One of the, we're actually going to start putting out some advertisements and some commercial ideas. And one of the selling points, I think, of the kit is like other mesh head kits that you can set up at home and play and not tick off your neighbors. It's how good these things sound in the headphones when you're doing that. Like, you are completely lost. You're in another world while you're playing on these. I am. I'm 15 or like 14, 13 when I sit down at this kit in my office. Mm-hmm. And I have my little moment. I'm like, dude, I got to get back to work. But I have to play through a song a day, luckily, because there's things I have to check.
Yeah.
Like every day.
Part of the job.
Yeah. They're, I think that this, hopefully, ends up in venues, if venues get back to it. And I want to talk to both of you about what's happened with COVID and that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, like, I want to see these in every single house of blues in the country. I want to see them in every single one. So when you show up and you want real drums, it's just the same as when they have their acoustic vendor with their kit. I want you to show up and there's the kit and everyone's speaking that language. And it won't be load in a whole bunch of sounds. This would be for the drummers that want to play you know, acoustic drum sounds, but with this type of setup. I'd really love to see that. And on the flip side of that, I would love to see this in people's condos and people's apartments and people's any kind of shared space, you know, where you can't put in the work to, you know,
right,
to get good. You can get good on these. You're inspired from the first hit, I believe.
Yeah,
absolutely.
100.
Totally.
Yeah.
Let's see what else we have here.
Some great questions.
Really good questions.
Ah, okay. Can I mix this kit with my Roland? If you mean, can you use? You can trigger these cymbals with the Roland for sure. You can. A lot of the drums are universal in that you just plug in quarter inch. But in order to get the full effect, like let's say, okay, Roland cymbals. They don't have a 360 for the kit. The VO6, the VAD 306 doesn't have 360 on the cymbals. Okay, so this you'd have to play and choke within this pizza, right in there, right? And if the cymbal turns, you have to turn the cymbal back. At least this is similar, and that way I have all three kits in my office, and I love all three kits. But the difference is, this is in order to get the full effect of what this symbol here can do, you got to do it with that brain, because that thing is speaking to this in a level. The guys that developed this are heavy. They're as heavy as it gets as far as engineering goes with electronic drums. They were in the game at the biggest for 20 years, and they're on fire now, going forward with this thing with the freedom to be creative.
Mm-hmm. 360.
Yeah.
Whoa, Mike, I wish you had one in the house when we were growing up. Mojo, okay, that's my sister Mo. Now I know who Mojo. Wait, what question did she answer?
She just wish you weren't so daggone loud when you were playing.
Okay, now exactly. I get it. That's my sister.
It's Mojo. My homework.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Oh, I wish I had one of these too when I was growing up, Mo. So I'll tell you a story about me and Mo.
That's
we
great.
Were both, we were both at home. She had this best. White Ford Ranger truck that she had, a used Ford Ranger. And I had a used Frankenstein drum set with every type of thing I could find on it. And we just came to a boiling point one day, and she took my, I had a little set of two rototoms, and she just stopped playing, and I was still going. I think I was like playing The Police. And and she ends up throwing these rototoms, and my hi-hat rod went through one of the heads, and I exploded, and I went out, and I punched her truck, and I put a dent in the front in her front fender that was mad with a fist, and then
oh my god,
yeah, it took. So kids, play drums because it helps you with anger issues. It helps you with, you know, sibling rivalries and whatnot, you know. No, anyway, love you, Mo, and thank you for being in the chat room. I know you got tons of stuff going on, good stuff, but stuff. Let's see, are the left right audio inputs for play along tracks, does John's kit work as an acoustic kit? Okay, two parts. As far as the left-right audio, so left-right audio inputs. Okay, this is the way the inputs work. You can take Bluetooth, like I do this in my office, like I said, every day. This thing is always on. Bluetooth is always sending from it. So as soon as I turn on, I have it off because I don't want to drain my battery, but I just get on my phone with my iPhone, turn on the Bluetooth, it matches immediately. I go into Apple Music, and I pick whatever song I want, and it's in the ears. So another way you can do it is there's a just the normal 8-inch stereo jack going in. Now the outputs on it are amazing. This is also another huge selling point for me once I got to do it in real life. And that's there's a micro USB which goes, you know, to an adapter to a USB into your laptop. Immediately, if you pull up any DAW from GarageBand up to, you know, Logic or Pro Tools or Ableton, whatever you have, it lines up eight plug and play, eight channels of audio. And those things, you just have to arm the tracks, and it's already speaking to the computer, to the DAW. So it also sends, through that USB, it sends MIDI. Mm. So in your MIDI send, you can open up, you know, your favorite drum module, you know, online and play those as well. So even if these aren't, you know, cutting the mustard or whatever in that mix, you can also have, you're going to be hearing these MIDI drums synced exactly to the drums that you're playing here, and it's recording all of it. Okay, so this is like a kind of a breakthrough in a heavy use tool that it has. So it's got the USB audio out eight inputs plug and play with USB MIDI simultaneously. Game changer. Mm-hmm. And as far as the outputs, the analog outputs, like on here right now, we're going out four analog outputs. So it's basically kick, snare, and we're throwing everything else. We're subbing everything else on three and four. And then you pan accordingly, right? So we've got these kits panned kind of wide for that purpose. And then, let's see. And then there is a stereo, to get back to your question. There is one stereo output that goes out. So you can go out stereo. You can go out four channels of analog out, or you can go out eight channels of USB audio plus USB MIDI out. So...
Wow.
That was a lot.
Yeah.
Let's see what else we got here. Let's see.
It's all really good questions.
They have apps like Tempo Slow Mo that let you slow the tune down without dropping the pitch. Yes. Oh, you must be answering somebody else's question. I got to step it up. Let's see. What is an optimal recommended amplifier for live sound? EFNOTE actually makes, there's a stereo, I'm not sure that'll be shipping in the States, but I'll find out. Please hit me at mikeb@artesia-pro.com, and I'll get back to you on this. But I used it at NAMM, and it was phenomenal. We had everybody up playing these things on this little stage, and it's basically two speakers, you know, a speaker on each side. You've, I think it's a two-band parametric EQ that's on it, and you can go. It's Bluetooth. You can go, all the connectivity is there. So you could have those right behind you in the house that you're trying to be quiet in, or you can go down and do a high-tech busk. No, don't do that. But anyway, that's definitely the one that I'll recommend. Outside of that, yeah, get back to me because I don't want to speak on other. I'm not sure how else. What would be the best? Do you guys have any ideas on this?
Well, I have another brand of that just because I didn't have an EFNOTE available.
Sure, no, it's okay.
And it was amazing.
Yeah, what is it?
Just it was the little Alesis Strike Force.
Gotcha.
Just one of them, man. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't get it past five before my wife started yelling from the third story.
Yeah.
So, this is you going like that,
yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah, good enough. That's good input.
And I was on the ground floor, you know. Mm-hmm.
So to speak.
Yeah, yeah. All right.
Let's see. UFIPper, which that's a UFIP joke. Remember UFIP symbols?
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's amazing. They were always like I said, out of my league right here. They were always out of my league.
Oh,
and then it was
yeah.
Paper route money.
Yes,
that's right. And then it was
that's
like
right.
Splash.
That's
and
right.
Best, I still have that splash.
Oh, good
I still
for
have
you.
The UFIP splash, the 8-inch that I had when I was whatever,
13.
It doesn't sound like this, though.
That's a giant. It's really funny because that UFIP, UFIPper, the question is, how are the China type cymbal sounds?
Oh, man.
That's what you have in there right now,
that's
right?
That's right, yep.
Okay,
yep.
I don't have the monitor out here. Yeah, hit it one more time.
Had a clean that was?
That's a little one, though.
Could you get
it's like a...
Woo. Awesome.
Yeah.
Let's see. Okay, the diameter. I saw that. Where'd that go? What are the diameter of the pads on the set Tris is playing? Okay, so here we have
tens, right?
Yes, two tens. The toms are tens.
12.
Mm-hmm. The snare and the floor tom are 12. Oops. Mm-hmm. The kick drum. I just messed up the light. And it's still messed up. The kick drum that's now well lit is a it's actually an 8-inch, but I mean once it gets down to this size you're not really doing anything with the size, but mm-hmm. So that answers that. The sizes on the 5 are it's a 16-inch kick drum, it's a 10-inch rack tom, and a 12 and a 12 for the snare and the floor tom. Let's see. You can plug your phone into the e-drum brain, hear the tune through the headphones with the drums. I'm assuming that would work with Bluetooth. Works with hardwire. Somebody else is answering that question. Thank you guys for the nice evening. Be safe. Gotta go. All right, Laurent. Thank you so much for being here. It's awesome. Love your questions. And like I said, hit me on email, and we'll continue the conversation. You guys want to do some more playing?
Yeah.
Oh,
you want
yeah,
it?
Of course.
Man. Don't threaten me with a good time. Right?
Right. How you feeling? What you feeling?
About... We'll be right back.
get out of here, man.
Man, you
scratched
me good, man.
Yeah, man. Wow, unreal.
Oh, you, brother. Oh, man.
There are levels to this. There's no doubt about that. And it's beautiful to see it, man. It's beautiful to see it displayed. You guys are such a rarity, you know, together. That is just a beautiful thing.
Mm. Man. I love
it's
this.
It's my
man.
Brother right
yeah.
there.
Full my brother.
It shows. There's a lot of hate. A lot of hate.
Oh, man.
Well, that's it. That was so fun. This is the first time we've done it. Can I announce what is... Okay, then I won't. Believe me. No. That was so fun. This is the first episode. We've got more exciting ones that are coming up. Really want to thank John Paris...
Yes.
Thank you, bro.
Yes.
My brother.
Tris Imboden.
Thank you. Thank you.
Clap, 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 clap. artesia-pro.
Yes.
EFNOTE drums. Modern yes. Drummer Magazine. Entertalk Media, which is where this is all coming from, has made all this stuff possible. And we'll see you soon. There's so much on the way. Come to, artesia-pro.com and check out the kits, check out the other products, check out me, check out everybody. Checking out. Later.
All right.
Yeah, man.